joining us today to look through those are the editor of politics.co.uk, Ian Dunt, and the Times columnist, Melanie Phillips. Nice to see you both. And Ian, let's talk about the Middle East first of all. That article by Dor Gold there, making the point that as we cover the conflict, we're not hearing a lot about Iran's undoubted involvement.
I don't know so much about that. I mean, Israeli government officials very often talk about Iran's involvement, its links with Hamas. We see that quite frequently in right-wing newspapers. The trouble is, because we all have this sense of horrified emotional anguish of what we see, people seek someone to blame. It's quite easy just to pick one of those. Whereas, in fact, the blame is spread really very evenly indeed. And if you're going to write an article that's talking about Iran and Hamas, it would also make at least some sense to talk about Netanyahu's grotesque, persistent attempts to entrench inequality and hostility between groups within Israel, the very aggressive use of Israeli military techniques in the occupied territories, and on and on. So it becomes part of the infinite blame game, when in reality, right now, there is more than enough blame to go around.
Melanie, I mean, it was what was happening in Israel, particularly in Jerusalem, which appears to have sparked this latest round of hostilities rather than Iran, wasn't it?
Well, I think there are a number of possible reasons why it was sparked, and maybe no one in particular. One of the most important was the rivalry between Hamas and Fatah. Mahmoud Abbas cancelled the planned elections for the Palestinian Authority, in which he was going to lose to the Hamas. And the Hamas then, quite reasonably from their point of view, decided to launch a war to show that, you know, they could take the fight to the enemy much better than Mahmoud Abbas.
Weren't they responding to what happened at Damascus Gate and what happened on the Temple Mount as well, rather than actually...
Well, what happened at the Temple... Indeed, I'm glad you made that. I'm glad you raised that point. What happened at the Temple Mount was that Palestinian Arabs used the mosque, Al-Aqsa Mosque, as an ammunition point, where they stored rocks and Molotov cocktails with which they started to assault Jewish worshippers at the Western Wall and other Jews in the city, as well as the police. The Damascus Gate Israeli police sought to defuse the situation by restricting admission. So let's get it right. The Israelis have all the time been responding to Arab aggression.
Ian? It just seems a very sort of simplistic assessment of what's going on. And the danger is every time that we just say all of the blame lands on one side and none of the blame lands on the other, you have a rather obvious continuation of the grim cycle in which we see there is no moral comparison. There is a very difficult case to make when you're talking about an occupying force and an occupied force. There is also a very severe distinction in the level of power, in the level of money, in the level of equipment that is being operated. There is a very severe distinction in the level of loss of life. Now, these are grim ratios that we use. But in each and every time we see these conflicts mount, it's about 1 in 10. 10 Palestinians killed to 1 Israeli, and right now the figures are considerably higher than that, including dozens of children so far. It's no point just saying that these children are sort of collateral damage or the result of Hamas, you know, choosing to use them as human shields. The reality is that the Gaza Strip is an open prison. It is the third densest polity in the world. If you keep people in those conditions very close together, anytime you launch a military endeavor in that territory, you will find that you are killing women and children, and that is precisely what has taken place.
Melanie?
Well, this is just, I mean, Ian talks about, you know, emotion getting in the way. I mean, my goodness me, this is just emotional ignorance, really quite extraordinary ignorance. Israel has had so far something like 3,700 rockets coming at it from Gaza. Those rockets are all intended to kill Israeli civilians. That is a war crime. The undoubted casualties among civilians in Gaza are almost all to do with the fact that either the Hamas have deliberately sited their weapons of annihilation against Israel under and in apartment blocks, schools, hospitals, and so on. Secondly, which makes their own civilians hostages, right, human shields, and cannon fodder. The Israelis, actually, unlike any other armed militia in the world, warns civilians to get out of civilian-occupied buildings in various ways. The Hamas are known over many years to tell the captive Palestinians in those buildings, captive by Hamas, not to move in order that they should die, in order that they should be killed, in order that youthful idiots like Ian will then find a moral equivalence. Finally, there is the issue of the Hamas rockets falling short, and we don't know how many. The Israelis say one-third of the Hamas rockets are falling short in Gaza. It is reasonable to suppose that some of those casualties in Gaza of civilians have been killed by the Hamas's own rockets.
Well, I did want to move on, but Ian, I'll give you a final quick reply to that.
I mean, there's nothing much to say. You know, Hamas is a death-loving, totalitarian, terrorist cult. That is clearly what it is. That, in and of itself, does not mean that Israel is not responsible for the actions that it takes. It is responsible when it bombs the buildings containing journalists, when it kills women and children. And any kind of moral assessment that looks at that situation and says Hamas bad, Israel good, is obviously deeply simplistic.
All right, Melanie, from your perspective, do you think that the British government is now moving the goalposts and making a bit of a mess of coming out of this pandemic?
Well, a mess, yes. I think it's made a mess from the start because it's reacted too slowly from the start to the evidence that was being put before it. But the goalposts are moving. You know, you can't blame the government for the fact that the Indian variant has suddenly arrived. And that causes chaos. So I have every sympathy with the government at this stage in being cautious and saying to the public very honestly, we don't know whether we can open up after June the 22nd and the 21st in the way that we wanted to, because we're concerned about this variant. Where I think they are completely at fault, and I find this baffling now, and I have found it baffling throughout the pandemic, is that while the British public are being locked down and, you know, with all the problems that that has caused and the resentment, the airports have been admitting thousands of people from India. I mean, during the time when Boris Johnson was being advised by his scientific advisors that the Indian variant was very dangerous and he should lock down the airport against people coming from India and other suspect places, while he was havering around, something like 20,000 people from India came in. This is just madness. So, I mean, this is a mess in every sense. You know, the government is partly responsible for the mess, partly it's reacting to events which are beyond its control. It's reacting too slowly. Sometimes it gets it right, sometimes it gets it wrong. It's going to take quite a while after this thing is finished, and let's hope it does eventually finish, before we can really make a fair-minded assessment, I think.
Well, from following what Ian's been saying, I suspect that is a subject to which there's some agreement, but I'm afraid we're going to have to edit there. Thank you very much indeed.